And this session is pagers. Most people have them, but few people really know what they're all about and exactly how they work. And I'm even going to talk about setting up your own paging system and some little tricks you can do with setting up your own paging system. I'm going to start by just giving a basic overview on how pagers work. Excuse the atrocious handwriting. Okay, that's a really basic diagram of how a paging system works. Starts with a telephone. Person picks up his phone and dials the paging system. It then goes into a computer system, which will receive the touch tones and convert it to a format that can be sent over the air efficiently. Usually paging systems, they have several different formats. The most common is just basic ASCII data that's sent via frequency shift keying. It then goes to a radio transmitter, which then sends it out over the air. And then when your pager receives it, your pager goes off. It's pretty basic when you really look at it. Now, looking inside a pager, okay, as you can see, there's really not a lot to them. Pager is basically an antenna, really small antenna, hooked into a radio receiver, the output of which goes to a demodulator decoder, and that'll just sit there as long as you have it on. It'll wait for your specific serial number for your pager, which is called a cap code. When it receives your cap code, that little decoder demodulator turns itself on and receives your data. Your phone number, if you have a numeric pager, or if you have one of the alphanumeric ones, you can get a complete message. And when it receives it, it then alerts you through an alerting system. Pagers usually have a buzzer, a vibrator, or a beeper, audio beeper that goes off. And that's basically how it works. As you can see, it's fairly simple. There are different types of pagers. Okay, starting, the first pagers that came out were tone only. The pager got the code and it beeped. You didn't know who beeped you. All you know is that someone was trying to get in touch with you. These were typically hooked into answering machines, and when someone called your answering machine, a little black box would then call your pager and page you. Or doctors used them, because the only person that would be paging the doctor would be his office, so he'd know how to call his office. Then someone got the bright idea to actually market an answering machine with a pager, actually marketing a voicemail system with a pager, and that came out to be a tone VRS pager. VRS stands for voice response system. When you call it up, it's just like an answering machine or a voicemail account. You get the person's message, and they prompt you to leave yours. You leave it, and then the person gets paged. And that tells a person to call his VRS system and retrieve his messages just like a voicemail. There's then a voice paging system, which isn't seen much in commercial use, but a lot of public safety agencies still use it. And with that system, you call it up, it picks up the phone, and you're on the air. It sends out the cap code for the pager, opens up a channel to the airwaves, and whatever you say goes out over the guy's pager. It also goes out to anyone else who happens to be listening in on a scanner. Then you have the display pagers, which are the numeric and the alphanumeric pagers, which I'm sure everyone here is familiar with. Those are the ones where you either call and enter in your phone number, at which point the person is paged with the phone number that you're calling. You could also enter in a little up to a 14-digit numeric code, so you can even send short little messages with it. And then there are the alphanumeric pagers, which you call up and the operator asks you for the pager code, and you give it to her and you tell her the message, and then they go and page the person. Okay, now that you know how easy, how simple pagers are, there are a number of ways you can set up your own paging system. Radio Shack will sell you one for $100, which is a basic tone pager. get a little paging terminal. It actually works on the CB band. And you can get, with a decent antenna, about a 20-mile range out of it under the best of conditions. Typically, it's about a mile. Quarter-wave whip, which would be about, let's see, about 3 meters high. So you're talking about a 9-foot high antenna. And you can get a 20-foot range on those CB tone pagers. You can also set up your own voice paging service if you have any type of radio transceiver that's capable of setting up, sending out any type of signaling. I have a system like that here, which I'm going to demonstrate. And at that, it will, you're basically opening up a frequency, sending in a code, and then the unit will open up its receiver and you can send a message. And if Adam is out there, okay. Now I've set this up on an amateur band frequency. It's probably one of the best places to do this because you can run a decent amount of power. It does require a license, but the no-code technician license is very easy to get. And basically most modern transceivers will have a function in them called digital code squelch, and that is basically a pager. Your receiver sits there and it waits for a code. In this case, they're using touch tones, and Adam just keyed up with my touch tone code, and I just got paged. So, do I have any questions? Go ahead. Well, Mr. Pins, why don't you explain your involvement in a covert military project called Project Marigold, which, as I've been told, is an anti-hacker Contelpro activity. And while you're at it, why don't you... You can speak. You can get on and you could speak. Or why don't you talk about where you're getting your funding for PNET? Apparently, from what's been seen, people are wondering how you're getting all these points of presence and not getting any money in on it.
All of these points of presence, unless you believe that I have one, that we have one, actually two points of presence, Cheshire, Connecticut, Hartford, Connecticut, and of course, Paul Forward from on this point. But actually, what I see is you're dodging the entire question.
Or, Mr. Pins, if you want to talk about... the PunkCon event, what about you putting my handle on the system that you hacked into?
I do not deny that. You were in the same room with me. I have actually pled guilty to this, and I am currently out of probation. I would actually like to know how...
So why did you go and put someone's handle on a system that you just hacked into? It seems that would be a violation of hacker ethics.
Let's go! So we can go back to your footage slightly.
Could you please repeat the question as I was speaking to someone else at the time?
Which question?
Whatever you just said.
Well, what about you putting your handle on my on the system that you hacked into? That would seem to be a violation of hacker ethics, don't you think?
Mr. Icom was in the room with me. As we were, it was pretty much just like a joke. He was also present at a conference prior to, and some other systems had been violated, and it was kind of some of the same types of things. It was mostly just a big joke. There were three accounts added to this RS6000. One was my handle, which, of course, in haste, I typed wrong, and instead of coming out IXOM, it came out IXOM with a letter U. There was one by the name of the conference that happened to be being held, which was PumpCon, and of course, Mr. Icom's. The company that was involved with this was Bob Stores, which is just a retail chain in Connecticut. And of course, they had an AIX system with a nice announcement that said, welcome to Bob's AIX and the version number and stuff, and an unpassworded root account. This company, of course, along with the district attorney, I was facing 10 felony counts, including 3 forgeries, because Mr. Thomas Icom was the first person to be arrested at this conference because he had an illegal weapon. Being military, and that he was in the reserve, I don't know if he still is, it's not really relevant. But the military police had to come in, and, you know, he was pressured into talking about what I had been doing when they entered the room.
Well, Ron, as I recall it, you did put my handle on the system, which is a violation of hacker ethics. Now, I don't know what you were trying to do, because I sure didn't ask you to put on a system. As far as me getting arrested for an illegal weapon, that never occurred. So,
is the reason that you were not arrested because of your rollover?
None of that ever occurred.
So then Mr. Kenneth Citarella, the assistant district attorney for Westchester County, is in fact lying to me and saying that you were going to be the key witness.
Anything that occurred between you and Ken Citarella is your business, and I was not privy to it.
You're dodging the question. I asked you if Ken Citarella was lying to me when he told me that you were going to be the key witness in my trial.
For all I know, he could have been.
Okay. I don't know how to respond to that one, actually, because that's just really weird. But actually, folks,
you could try leaving, Ron.
Well, for those people, excuse me. For those people that did see what happened earlier between two other people who shall remain nameless, I'm not pushing him. I haven't hit him. I'm not a violent person. I know he isn't himself. I'm on 3 years probation. No big deal. I had to pay $1,000.
It's a good thing that you're on 3 years probation because you are disrupting the conference and we would like you to leave.
Okay. What? Excuse me. Would they like me to step down?
I just want to say that I, for one, actually am interested in hearing a little more about this whole celebrated PumpCon. There's this PumpCon action here. As we all know, yes, Ixom here. When we were doing registration, I found his sheet, and we finally said, "Hey, look, it's Ixom." I mean, I don't want to insult you or anything, but
right.
He's a funny guy. And Tom here. I mean, there's no parallel for Tom. And all I can say is, I'd love to see maybe some sort of panel thing, right? I don't know if you guys want to talk it out in front of everyone. I don't know if that's cool with you two. I don't know how you feel about that, Tom. I know Ixon does.
Yeah, I think that's.
You want to do like a panel thing?
I'd like to have it with other people.
Okay, right. Like I said,
right.
I mean,
want to interrupt. And so I was going to say that maybe we could schedule something for a little later. How's that sound? How many people are going to be here later on in the evening? You want to come? You see him duke it out? All right.
Hold on, I just want to make this known.
The open mic time got eaten because now that's why we're only 1 hour behind schedule now, because previously we were much farther. Behind.
Actually, okay, then I'm sorry if I delayed
no,
it slightly.
Don't worry, man.
Because I am on probation, just so in case anybody here is a Fed, I do have my permission slip to be here for my probation officer.
As we know, no one here at Hope would ever be caught breaking the law. No one here would ever be caught doing anything to a telephone or a computer. And that is why this is a place for law-abiding citizens like Mr. Ixom. All right, thank you very much.
You.
You want to stay for the rest of this, but I'm just keep
quiet. No, I'm just waiting. I'm not here to pull. I'm not here to...
How about the
beat? Okay. I can smell it. All right, so about this, Tom, take your time, all right?
Okay. But, well, does anyone have any questions on paging systems? Anything? Which one? Yeah, Adam, if you could, where is he? No, it's all right. If Adam can key up again on the frequency, we can do another demonstration of it. Go ahead. Okay, as you see, he sent me a touch tone code out, and that waked my receiver off. And now I can hear everything he has to say. You could do it with a regular scanner if you had a touch tone decoder hooked into it. I'm using an amateur band transceiver right now. Those have built-in digital paging. You can use any type of receiver or any type of signaling format you want. Excuse me? We're signaling with two handband transceivers. Go ahead. It all depends. Now, the system we're using right now has a range of about 5 miles. If you use more, we're only using 5 watts into a really low gain antenna. If you used more power, bigger antenna, if you could find a ham repeater that passes touch tones, few of them do anymore because they mute them out for the patch functions, you can go 70, 80 miles without any problems. Go ahead.
Not to be insulting, but you put up these big blocks with no detail, something that you can find in a children's program on pagers.
I'm trying to keep it simple because I don't know how technical the audience is. Well, typically most of that stuff is done with frequency modulation because that's the standard for VHF and UHF where the pagers are at. The data format is sent in FM-FSK, in which the zeros and ones of the binary signal are each the zero is represented by one FM frequency, and then it's shifted up a number of kilohertz for the one. On audio frequency shift keying, which is another method used on the older pagers, it's done by audio tones. One tone represents a one, one tone represents a zero. Okay.
But you mentioned before you use a standard ASCII, at least most of them
do. Yeah, most of the standard formats that are used for your POGSAC, which is the most common format, is ASCII data. What's the data sent in? And the standard data, which is POGSAC, is sent in ASCII. You right over there, go ahead. There are three different rates. One is 512 baud, the other is 1200, and now they have a system out which is running at 2400 baud. It's slow compared to some, most people using modems over the landlines are running at 28.8, 14.4. But it's RF and it's only 12 characters for a numeric display pager, so you don't really need a lot of speed. They do have a basic parity check, but that's it. Go ahead. What type of security systems are built into the EEPROM on a Motorola Advisor? There are none. There's no need for it. The double EEPROM is set up through a programmer, which is hooked into your PC, and there's no security. You're just programming up a cap code. You can very easily clone a pager if you have a pager that's programmable through that method. You could easily clone a pager and have 2, 3, 4, even 10 pagers on the same frequency and cap code. Excuse me? That's interesting. I haven't had much experience in the Motorola Advisors. I was mostly working with Bravos, and they're fairly easy.
Right, because they only have one cap code, as opposed to four cap codes on an advisor.
Is that password to read messages, or just
to get access to
the cap codes themselves? Okay, any other questions? You back there, go ahead. The data that's being sent out is asynchronous. Mm-hmm. Excuse me? Yes, regular start and stop in 8-bit format. Anyone else?
One thing. You referred to something being a touch code, but it's actually
Well, DTMF is the generic name for it. Touchtone is an AT&T trademark, but DTMF, dual tone multi-frequency tones, and touch tones are the same thing. Anyone else? Okay, well, thank you for your time. Thank you.